Hello and welcome back to online worship with the McLeod First Baptist Church. How are you doing? Has it been a good week? I sure hope so. If it hasn't been a good week, then I'm really very sorry, and I hope you know that we care. Let us know if there's anything we can do for you or your family. We're here, and we're always glad to hear from you. I miss you, but I am so glad that we can worship in this way together. Today during worship, we're going to take some time to recognize Memorial Day and the sacrifices made by so many of our servicemen and women. I don't know what day you will be watching this, but I know it's a great day to give thanks for those who made the ultimate sacrifice for our country and for each one of us. Thank you to all who have served and to those who have supported and loved those who have served. Along with our Memorial Day recognition, we have some great music for you to sing along with. We have some wonderful special music that I think at home you can also sing along with if you want to. And Pastor has a great message from the Word and a special time for kids. It's going to be good. To get us started, I thought we would look at a passage from the Gospel of John, chapter 15. Now Jesus is in Jerusalem. In just days he will willingly go to the cross to be crucified, taking on the punishment of all of our sins. In those last few days, he continues preparing his guys for a time when he will no longer be with them. He is reminding them of his teachings, and he is showing them his love. Let's listen to the words of Jesus spoken to the disciples, but saved by God for us today. In John chapter 15, we're going to start with verse 9 this morning. It says, "As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you obey my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no other than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I call you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and anointed you to go and bear fruit that will last. Then the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. This is my command: love each other." That's a lot of love right there. The Father loves the Son, Jesus. Jesus loves us. We are to remain in his love. We show our love when we obey his commands, and we are to love one another. Love must be important. Jesus took those last few moments with his disciples to let them know that they are loved and to tell them to love others. It seems like an easy concept. Of course we want to love others. We're good people. When it comes down to it, it can be hard. Some folks are hard to love. Oftentimes, we are hard to love. Maybe that's why Jesus reminded us in those last few days that we are commanded to love one another. Jesus says that the greatest way to love is to lay down your life for a friend. He's going to demonstrate that love in just a few short days. He's going to live out that sacrifice as an example to his people of his love for them and us. He's going to lay down his life for you and for me and for everyone because of his love for us. That should knock us to the ground. That should fill us full of love. That should make us want to rejoice. That should make us want to worship. So before we worship, let us pray together. Heavenly Father, you are love. And because of you, we can love others. You are all good. You are light in a dark world. Thank you for loving us, for providing for us, for teaching us through your example. We do not always follow your example. We don't always do as you have called us to. We are stubborn people who too often choose the selfish things over the loving things. We look for the faults in others instead of looking for the good. Forgive us for our many sins. Help us to see your path for us and help us to choose you and your way for us. We know you have called us to worship. Give us hearts full of praise and ears open to hear your message. Thank you for this time of worship, Lord. It may not be the way we would have chosen, but help us to see the gift of worship in all its forms. Give us patience as we wait to gather together. Help us to love one another first in all things. We pray these things in Jesus' name as we choose to worship as church family. Amen.
Now we'll sing Amazing Love. This week, we remember. The purpose of Memorial Day is to remember those men and women who have given their lives in the service of their country. So let us not forget.
Extraordinary men and women went before us with unmatched resilience, enduring hardship, when called upon to defend and liberate. They said, yes. They found courage to rise with every sun, loyalty toward their country, discipline for every command. Even in the darkest hours, they said, yes. They cherished and fought for freedom, so those coming behind them were assured of it. And when the moment came for them to give it all, their futures never to be written, they said, yes. Today, we think upon their sacrifice and find our way to honor them, saying yes to making the most of what they gave us and filling the earth with God's goodness. We thank them for their yes. They will never be forgotten.
Father, we thank you for those who have given their lives in the service of our country. And we pray, Father, that you would help us to never forget the sacrifices which they made. And we pray, Father, that you would help us then to live forward, to carry forward the legacy of freedom and sacrifice which they exemplify. Lord, I pray that you would help us to live our lives worthy of those sacrifices. And I pray, Lord, that we might be a country that is worthy of the prices that have been paid. Lord, I pray you would bless each of our people, each one who is watching and listening. And I ask that you might grant to them your comfort and your peace and your presence. Watch over all those who are ill. Please be with those who are in nursing homes, those who are feeling lonely and sad. I pray, Lord, that you would also bless our church and help us to be the church together, even as we're separated. And I pray, Lord, that you would help us to have wisdom as we consider and find ways to join together again. Lord, please just use us and help us to be what you ask us to be, which is like lights in your world. Thank you for this privilege. Please bless our church, please bless our people, and please bless our nation. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
It's been a couple, 3 weeks now that we've been challenged, I guess you might say, different situations that have come up and things that we've never experienced before in our lives and haven't even happened for decades. It might be discomforting for a lot of people, but if you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you can without a doubt know that it's well with your soul, with your eternal being. You're there. God's got it. You're in good shape. We're going to sing now. It is well with my soul.
All right, it's time for the kids. So first we're gonna start off with a joke. This is a really good one. You're gonna love this one. So there was a boy with a monkey on his shoulder and he was walking down the street when he passed by a policeman. The police officer stopped him and he said, "Now, young man, I think that you had better take that monkey to the zoo." Well, the next day, the boy was walking down the road again with a monkey on his shoulder again when he passed the same policeman again. And so the policeman stopped him again and he said, "Hey there, young man." He said, "I thought I told you to take that monkey to the zoo." And the boy said, "I did. Today I'm taking him to the movies." I love you.
Hi, guys. It's time for the kids. So I'm sitting here with this little bird. It must be baby time for all of our kids' times. Last week we had a little baby rabbit, and we learned about how God watches over us like a mama protects her babies. Now we have this little guy who's been sitting out on the church railing by the playground. And that just reminds me, what this little guy is doing is he's a little robin, and he's learning how to fly. And so he flutters around a little bit and goes from one rail to the next, and then he sits and he rests, because I think he just gets kind of tired. But he's learning, and you can hear his mama nearby, and she's watching over to make sure that he's okay and encouraging him, I think, in the way that robins encourage one another, that that he can do it and that he can fly. This reminds me of a fact that all of us are just kind of learning, that as kids we're learning what it means to be followers of Jesus, and as grown-ups we're learning the same thing. It reminds me of a verse in 2 Peter chapter 3 where it says, but grow in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. So we're still growing, just like this little bird is learning how to fly. We're still learning how to follow Jesus. Let me pray with you. Father, thank you for our sweet kids, and bless them. Help them to be able to grow in their knowledge of you and to follow you, and help them to be able to fly and to soar in their faith. Just bless each one in Jesus' name. Amen. I sure love you.
Peace like a river, I got peace like a river. I got peace like a river in my soul. I got peace like a river, peace like a river. I got peace like a river in my soul. I got love like an ocean, love. I got love like an ocean, I got love like an ocean. I got love like an ocean in my soul. I got love like an ocean, I got love like an ocean, I got love like an ocean in my soul. I got joy like a fountain, I got joy like a fountain, I got joy like a fountain in my soul. Oh, I got joy like a fountain, I got joy like a fountain, I got joy like a fountain in my soul. Oh, got peace, love, and joy like a river. I got peace, love, and joy like a river. I got peace, love, and joy like a river in my soul. I got peace, love, and joy like a river. I got peace, love, and joy like a river. I got peace, love, and joy like a river in my soul. Got peace, love, and joy like a ocean. Peace, love, and joy like an ocean. Peace, love, and joy in an ocean in my soul. I got peace, love, and joy like a fountain. I got peace, love, and joy like a fountain. I got peace, love, and joy in a fountain in my soul.
Number 488 now. He keeps me singing.
Oh, my life was wrecked by sin and strife.
Sing Victory in Jesus.
Hi guys, how you doing? We're going to spend some time today in God's Word, and so I want to invite you to have your Bible ready. We're going to talk about something really tough. We're talking about prayer, and I have a lot of passages to share with you, and we're going to think about some kind of difficult things, but I pray that God will bless it and that it will be a blessing to you. As we begin, would you pray with me, please? Father, I ask that you would help us as we open your word. I ask that you would speak to us. I'm praying that the Holy Spirit would be at work as we gather. And I pray, Lord, that you would open our ears and open our hearts. Help us to know what you would want us to know. Please use me as your messenger. I'm praying, Father, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart might be holy and pleasing and acceptable in your sight. God, you are my rock and our redeemer. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to start off with John chapter 14, beginning at verse 13. We're thinking about prayer, and we read these words. Jesus is speaking, and he says this, John 14, 13, I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. When I was first starting out in ministry, a little lady came to me after church and she asked me, why don't you pray in Jesus's name? She said, don't you know that he'll give you anything you want if you just ask in his name? Now to that sweet little lady, in my name were like magic words, like a genie granting any three wishes. And I used to honestly think a prayer like that. I thought the purpose of prayer was to change God's mind or to convince him to see things my way. You understand? It was prayer from a human perspective. And I think I derived that perspective from this passage. It's James chapter 5. James chapter 5. And we're going to take a look at verse 16. You'll know this very well. It says in the second part of James 5:16, the prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. And so from that passage, I concluded that the prayer of a righteous man is powerful. There's power in prayer. And there are lots of passages in the Bible that confirm that, that tell us that God grants us what we ask of him when we pray. But my emphasis as I read this verse was on the man. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. And that made me think, like I think many think, made me think this. If I am just righteous enough, or if I do things just right, then God will answer my prayer. And that led me to think, if God doesn't answer my prayer the way that I want him to answer my prayer, then it must be my fault. I must not be the right righteous man. I must not be using the right words, must not be including the phrase in Jesus' name. That is prayer from a human perspective. It's focusing on the man. I thought our prayers could change God's mind, could alter his plan for human history. But that idea that I could change God's mind through prayers, that idea honestly contradicts some basic truths about God and about God's mind and about God's plan. So we're going to start with four truths from God's word. All of those truths are swirling around the question, do prayers change God's mind? So truth number one is this. God's plan is established from the beginning. Take a look with me at Isaiah chapter 61, I believe it is. Isaiah chapter 46. Isaiah chapter 46, beginning at verse 10. God says this, I make known the end from the beginning, from ancient times, what is still to come. I say, my purpose will stand, and I will do all that I please. God's plan is established from the beginning. God, or Jesus calls that plan the kingdom of God, as you study in the New Testament, and God is always working to carry out his plan. His kingdom rolls on in spite of what we do, what we say, what we think. His kingdom always rolls on. Take a look with me at Proverbs chapter 19. Proverbs chapter 19 and verse 21. I told you there's a lot of passages today. Many are the plans in a man's heart, it says, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails. So truth number one is that God's plan is established from the beginning, that God carries forward his plan, his kingdom rolls on in spite of us. Truth number two is that God does not change his mind. We're going to all go all the way back to the Old Testament, to Numbers chapter 23. Numbers chapter 23 and verse 19. Here's what we read. God is not a man that he should lie, nor a son of man that he should change his mind. Does he speak and then not act? Does he promise and not fulfill? God does not change his mind. The third truth, then, is that God oftentimes chooses to work in sort of a partnership with humans. And he invites us to be a part of his kingdom as his kingdom plan rolls forward. It's sort of like, did you ever cook in the kitchen with your kids? Or did you ever work in the workshop downstairs in the basement building something with your kids? If you've done that, you know very well that it probably would be easier to do it by yourself. But you include them in the doing, in the baking, in the making. I think that God works like that. God allows us to be a part of his kingdom, his will being done. He's God. He doesn't really need us, but he chooses to involve us in partnership. Now, why would he do that? It's relationship. You want to have those moments in the kitchen, in the workshop with your kids, so you include them in your projects. God is like that. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about how prayer is a way that we can relate to and connect with God. It's about relationships, not about a list. Prayer is a way that God lets us help. Prayer is a way that God allows us to be a part of his kingdom plan as his kingdom rolls forward. There's one more principle for us to think about. The fourth truth is this. Faith is critical in our partnership with God. God desires, God demands that we trust him in faith. For this passage, we're going to take a look at Hebrews chapter 11, and we're going to begin. This is the Faith Hall of Fame. You know this passage well. But we're going to start off with Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 1, where there's a definition of what faith is. If it's necessary for our relationship, for our partnership with God, we better understand what it is. Hebrews 11, 1 tells us faith, it says, is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. And it goes on and shows us some examples of faith. I want you to take a look at verse 6, where it says, "And without faith, it is impossible to please God." Hear that? Without faith, it's impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who honestly seek him. So God gives us prayer as a way for us to express our faith. An example of that is this. In Matthew chapter 14, beginning at verse 22, you can read this passage. We spoke of it a couple of weeks ago. Matthew 14, 22. In that passage, the disciples are in a boat in the middle of the lake, in the middle of a terrible storm. And you might remember that Jesus came walking out to them on the water, and Peter asked if he could join Jesus. And so remember how Jesus said, "Come on out." And when Peter stepped over the side of the boat, and he did that, that is faith. Faith is being sure of what he hoped for, certain of what he could not see. And that moment, gave Peter a chance to express his faith. Prayer is like that. It gives us an opportunity to express our faith. You know what? Our expressions of faith, they really do matter. Here's an example of that. Our expressions matter. Jesus was just starting out his ministry. Take a look with me at Mark chapter 6. Mark chapter 6. Jesus is just starting out his ministry, and he went back to his own hometown, Nazareth. And we read this, Mark chapter 6 and verse 5. It says, he could not do any miracles there in his hometown, except lay his hands on a few sick people and to heal them. And he was amazed at their lack of faith. Jesus, in his will, wanted to heal people. But he didn't get to heal people because they didn't bring their sick people to him to be healed. They didn't ask. So he didn't heal. Expressions of faith matter. Here's another example. It's Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9 and verse 20. Matthew chapter 9 and verse 20. Take a look at this. Just then a woman who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years came up behind Jesus and touched the edge of his cloak. She said to herself, if only I touch his cloak, I will be healed. Jesus turned and saw her. Take heart, daughter, he said, your faith has healed you. And the woman was healed from that moment. What an amazing expression of faith. Jesus wanted, obviously, to heal that woman. Jesus had planned to heal that woman. It was in his will. It was in his plan. He came near to her and gave her a chance to express her faith. And once she did that, once she reached out, then he healed her. And so she was given a chance to enter into his will as it was being done. Prayer is like that. Our faith expressions really do matter to God. He wants us to turn to him in faith. So God gives us a way to turn to him in faith, and that way is through prayer. So prayer is a way that God gives us to express our faith, and it's a way for us to partner with him in his kingdom work. Now that understanding about prayer changes how we look at it, doesn't it? Remember my old take on prayer from James chapter 5 and verse 16? It says, the prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. I thought that meant that our prayers are powerful with the emphasis on us. But that's not it. Prayer is not powerful. God is powerful. It's God who does the work. And when we ask him in faith, he allows us to join in that work like a child helping her mama cook dinner in the kitchen. God does not change his kingdom plans because you ask him to do so in prayer. But he does change how you fit into his kingdom plans as he invites you to participate with him in faith. That's prayer from God's perspective. I think that's what Jesus was getting at when he shared in the very beginning of his sample prayer. Remember, he taught his disciples, here's how you pray. Take a look with me at Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount. Matthew chapter 6, I'm sorry, beginning at verse 9. He said, this then is how you should pray. Here's his sample. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, get that? Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Your kingdom come. Your will be done. Prayer is not so much about convincing God to do what we want, to do our will, as it is about joining God in carrying out his will. So, prayer is, first of all, a way that God gives us to express our faith. And second, a way for us to partner with him in his kingdom work. Now, looking at prayer from that perspective really does help. Especially it helps when it comes to unanswered prayers, because truth is, God does not always give us what we ask for or what we want. In the Garden of Gethsemane, just before he was arrested and killed on the cross, Jesus prayed. And Jesus asked God to spare him from the cross. If you are willing, he prayed, take this cup from me. Jesus asked God, don't make me do it. And still they killed him. Exactly what he was praying would not happen, that happened. But something else happened there in the garden in that prayer. Jesus is praying, please, Lord, not that. Please, Lord, anything but that. His heart is filled with grief and dread of what awaits him. Jesus said to his disciples, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Crucifixion is horrific. Who wouldn't pray, please, God, not that. Don't make me do that. Who wouldn't pray that? So Jesus prays that. But then he prays something else. Take a look with me at Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22 and verse 42. He says, please don't make me do this. And then he prays this. Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet, not my will, but yours be done. Do you see what Jesus prayed here? If you are willing, but not my will, yours be done. You see what he said? God, here's what I want, but what I really want is for your will to be done. That's the opposite of prayer from a human perspective. That prayer expresses absolute faith in God and absolute surrender to God's kingdom plan. Not my will, but yours. That's a third aspect of prayer. Prayer is a way for me to yield myself to God's will. Prayer is not convincing God to do it my way, but it is restating my desire to do it his way in faith. It's not about changing God's mind as much as it is about changing my mind and changing my heart. That's what Jesus was talking about, I think, in John chapter 14. I told you we'd come back to that passage. In John chapter 14, Jesus said this. Verse 13, John 14, 13, Jesus said, I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Son of Man may bring glory to the Father. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. That phrase, in my name, is not a magic phrase, but it is a blessed formula. To ask something in his name means to ask something on Christ's behalf. Verse 12 says this, I tell you the truth, anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these because I'm going to the Father. To ask something in his name means to ask according to his will. God does intervene when we pray, but he only answers according to his will. So when we pray according to his will, we say our prayers have been answered. When we are praying and what we're praying is not according to his plan, then we say, God didn't answer me. But he did. He just didn't answer the way we wanted him to answer. When we see prayer from a human perspective, we get mad when he doesn't answer the way we want him to answer. Sometimes we think, well, God let me down. We'll talk about that another time. But for now, let's just try to look at prayer from God's perspective. When you look at prayer from God's perspective, you begin to realize that God didn't let you down at all. When you look at prayer from God's perspective, you begin to realize that prayer is not about telling God what you want. Prayer is a way to spend some time with God in His workshop. Prayer is a way to spend some time in God's kitchen. Prayer is a way to help Him make something amazing. Father, I pray, first of all, thank you for prayer. Thank you that we can come to you and relate to you in prayer. Thank you that we can cry out to you with our heart's desires. And thank you that you care. I pray, Father, that you would help us to see prayer not as our wish list, not as our commands to you to give us what we want or demand, but instead help us to understand prayer for what it is. Help us to see prayer from your perspective and help us to cry out to you. Thank you, Father, for allowing us to be a part of your work, to be a part of your kingdom. Help us to yield to you completely and to see always your hand at work. Bless us now in Jesus' name, amen. This is hard stuff, I recognize, and so I would be very, very happy to visit with you more about this. In the future, we are going to talk about why God doesn't answer prayers and how to help with those situations. But I would love to talk with you about what we visited about today if you have questions. So please just give us a call. Something even more important that I would love to talk to you about is about Jesus. Remember, he was in that garden and he was praying, don't make me go there, don't make me do that. Well, he did that. He went there on the cross and he surrendered his life. The reason that he did that was love. The scripture tells us that he gave his life as a sacrifice out of love. Scripture tells us that greater love has no man than this, that he lay down his life for his brother. We think on that verse a lot during Memorial Day. Those who gave their lives that we might be free, Jesus did that for us. He laid down his life on the cross that we might be free, not free politically, but free from the burden of sin, free from the pain of separation from God. Jesus gave his life that we might be free from those things, that we might have relationship with God, that brokenness that comes from sin in our world might be repaired. Jesus gave his life out of love for you. And scripture tells us that all you need to do to have that forgiveness, all that you need to do to have that relationship with God is simply to ask. So I would love to talk with you about that. I would love for you to give us a call and we can just visit together. I can fix you up with one of our deacons or one of our Sunday school teachers, or Cheryl would be glad to talk with you, or I'd be happy to talk with you. We won't force you to make any decisions, but we'll talk with you and share with you about Jesus and his love for you. So I hope that you'll give us a call. It's so good to be able to gather together, even though we're not in the same room. I'm so grateful for our faithful, loving church family. I love you, and I just can't wait until we can gather together all in the same place. Until then, we're going to be the church. We're going to work hard to stay connected and to continue being the light that Christ calls us to be in our community. Until then, I'm praying for you, and I'm missing you, and I'm loving on you, and I'm looking forward to that day when we'll gather again. Until then, God bless.
Let's sing now. We are so blessed.